the work of the Holy Ghost is. And I believe we're going to have a revelation. I believe God's going to speak to us in a revelatory way. How many believe that? Will you lift your hands and pray with me as we bring Brother Crystal to the pulpit, that God would open up your understanding and that the scriptures would have free course in the hearts of men. Will you do that right now? Jesus, we thank you, oh God, for what we've already felt, your presence and your spirit, God. But now we pray that your understanding to the scriptures would come and we would receive a message, Lord, that would change and transform our lives. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Clap your hands to the Lord. Turn your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, verses 17 through 20. Praise Jesus. Lord, be with me. Bring your word. You teach and you preach the word. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. You may receive it. Church, communion and what we just read is what we know as the record in the Bible of communion. Communion, for some reason in the church, is one of the least understood things in the church. It's one of the things that we think of that we do around New Year, first of the year, or Easter time. And we think, okay, we do this communion. And when we think of communion, we think of the little cup, we think of the little wafer, and we know that the pastor's going to ask us to make sure that we're right with the Lord. And that's about as far as it goes. That's our understanding. Webster's says this. It says, an act of sharing, a sacrament of the church. Christ's death remembered, a fellowship of Christians with a common faith. But you see, communion is just as much a part of your walk with the Lord as receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost, as being baptized in the name of Jesus, as repenting, living for the Lord. Now, in this passage, Jesus simply has communion, or he has the apostles have communion. But he actually took time to teach communion in another passage. In John chapter 6, I'm going to read verse 40, and then I'm going to skip down to 47 and read all the way through 63. He said, this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. Skipping down to verse 47. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Whoso eateth, then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man, and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. Praise you, Jesus. This is that bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. These things said he in the synagogue as he taught Capernaum. Many, therefore, of his disciples, when they had heard this, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can hear it?" When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, "Doth this offend you? What if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life." In verse 40, church, and in three other passages in chapter 6 alone, Jesus uses the phrase, "I will raise him up on the last day," as he's teaching of communion. He also says that you'll have life if you eat of his flesh and drink of his blood. Now understand there's two types of life that the Bible talks about. One, if you look it up in the Greek, is where we get the word psyche, it's psyche life. It simply means you think, you're alive, you're animated. You move around, you breathe, you have a heartbeat. That's all that word means. But when Jesus says that if you eat of his flesh and you drink of his blood, you will have life in you, he's using another completely different word, a word called zoe, which means the God life, the eternal life, the abundant life, the happy, prosperous, joyful life. Zoe, life. If you eat of his flesh and you drink of his blood. He says six times during this passage, he says that he will raise you up at the last day. Raise you up at the last day. Wait a minute, aren't we all waiting for something that's supposed to happen, Pastor? Correct me if I'm wrong. Where we're supposed to be raised up? Something about end times? You know, I think it might be called the rapture. Jesus is teaching in communion that if you partake of his flesh and you partake of his blood, that he will raise you up the last day. He's making a direct reference, a direct comment toward the rapture. He says, "As I am in the Father and the Father is in me, you shall live by me if you partake of his flesh and his blood." But now, wait a minute. Did you know that there were actually 70 disciples? Starting out, there wasn't 12. There were 70.
That's right.
He teaches on communion. 58 of them says, "I'm out of here. This man is telling me we have to be cannibals. This man is teaching us to eat his flesh and drink his blood. I want no part of that. That's not what I was taught. Cannibalism is not right. It's not from God." And they left. 12 of them standing. He said, "The words that I speak are spirit. It's spirit that quickens." He looks at the rest and he says, "Will you leave too?" Peter had a habit of putting his foot in his mouth. But there was time when Peter hit it, and he hit the nail on the head.
Right.
And he looked at him and he said, "Will you leave too?" Peter said, "To whom else shall we go? As far as I know, there's nowhere else to go. With you are the words of life." Even if Peter didn't fully understand what was being taught right at the moment, he understood that it was deeper than the 58 who left thought it was. Now, it's a funny thing, when I read this passage, I have a little bit of benefit because of my upbringing, of understanding that when Jesus said, "Unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood," that what he's really saying is for you to take in to your being. To take in to who you are, his flesh and his blood. See, we have a saying in the Gypsy culture when somebody goes through intense hardship. We say, Chale Kino. Literally translated, it would make no sense at all in English. It translated word for word, it would literally say this, he ate suffering. Okay, that doesn't make any sense. But to us, it makes perfect sense, because we know to eat means to take into yourself. It means to make it one with your being. I also found out through my time that when the Jews speak, they use similar terminology that I was used to growing up. So when we say Chalek Ino, they consumed hardship. They took it into their being. It became one with them. Jesus is saying, take in my flesh. Take in my blood. Make it one with you. Make it one with you. There's something else that he said that we need to understand. He took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Two things I want to draw your attention to. Do this in remembrance of me. You see, we have a problem because we're raised in America. And America has this thing where they take the English language and we make the English language very generic. And we forget what words mean. We forget what's actually being said to us. If Brother McCoy and I had plans on going hunting this year and we didn't get to go, but I want you to imagine that we did get to go and we brought back a deer. And I brought that deer to your house and I wanted your help in processing that deer. I brought it in your house, I slapped it on your kitchen table, and I said, do me a favor, dismember this deer.
Dismember.
You would remember, you would know exactly what I meant. You would know that I meant to take the deer apart.
Right.
Well, the word remember, does not mean just to simply give thought. It does not mean just to recall, but it means to literally put back together. So he says, when you do this in remembrance of me. Let me see. I remember, Lord, that you came into this world through a virgin. I remember, Lord, that you taught in the synagogues. I remember, Lord, that you fed people. I remember that you healed the sick. You opened blinded eyes. I remember, Lord, that you forgave sinners. I remember, Lord, that you taught the word of God. I remember, Lord, that you were beaten, that you were falsely accused, and that you didn't yell back. You didn't whirl an accusation back. I remember, Lord, that you were nailed to a cross. And looking upon the very ones that were guilty, you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I remember, Lord, that you said, into thy hands I commit my spirit. But Brother Christo, I can't literally put him back together because he's not here. Yes, remember what he said. If you eat of my flesh, you drink of my blood. If you take me into your being, into your very person, if I do this in remembrance of him, if I take him into me, and I remember what he did, and I remember it by doing it in my own life, if I remember it by saying, I'm going to redo, I'm going to act out Jesus' ministry here on earth, but I remember him because I took him in. I made him one with me. I remember him. There's another thing that he says here. He says, this is my blood. Hold on. I'll make sure I put it. He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. This is another word that we don't truly recognize what it means. When we hear the word testament, we only think of the Bible. The word testament, and the word covenant, and the word contract are synonymous. You can interchange them. Now let me explain a little bit from, again, I'm going to use my world. When I used to seal code parking lots, when I used to do work on parking lots, I would go to a prospective client, and I would make a proposal. And the proposal would be formed of a contract. The contract would say, my end, that I would go and I would clean out the parking lot, I would fill the cracks, I would seal coat it, and stripe it. That was my end of the contract. His end of the contract was, is that he would provide me an empty parking lot to work on, he would leave me alone to work on it, and then he would pay me when I was done with the work. It's a contract. Do you know that the Lord has entered into a contract with you? He has made a proposal to you. He has said, I have this contract that I want you to sign. I have this contract that's written in my blood. Right. Didn't he say it right there? The New Testament?
Yeah.
That is done in his blood? Right? So it's a contract. He wants us to enter into a covenant relationship with him. A contractual obligation with him. What does the blood do for us? What's the Lord's end of this obligation? His end of the obligation is, in Matthew 26, he says, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood in the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Okay? So we know that the blood remits sin. It takes it away. That's what his blood is going to do for us. The Bible says, if you walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So not only does the blood take away our sin, but the blood literally washes away the effects of the sin. Because when you're a sinner, whether you realize it or not, the things that you've done has marred your spirit. It stained your very person. You ever met somebody, you don't know them at all, but as soon as they walk in the room, you look at them and you go, oh, something's not right there. They haven't done anything in front of you. They haven't sinned in front of you. They hadn't shot up. They hadn't killed no one. They didn't steal anything. But as soon as they walk in, you just know. That's because they carry the stain of their sin on their very person. And the blood of Jesus will cleanse us from that. The Bible also says this. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of him. The blood justifies us. What does justify mean? A lot of people have a problem with this word. I like the way I've heard people say it all my church life. Just as if I've never done it. It puts you in right standing with the Lord. So the blood, God's thing to us, his obligation to us, is he's saying, enter into this contract, enter into this covenant with me. And my blood will, number one, take away your sins. Number two, it will cleanse the very effect of the sin. And number three, I will put you in right standing with me through my blood. So when we take he's obligated himself in this contract. Mm-hmm. What about the body? Now, I'm doing a lot of reading, so I'm asking you to be patient with me. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 31. For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup, pay attention to this, church. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Pay attention to that. Not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. Notice that it says in verse 27, wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood. It then says, but let man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. Why does the pastor tell you, let us take time to examine ourselves? Because the Bible says that if you eat the bread and you drink the blood unworthily, you drink what to yourself? Damnation. It says you'll be guilty of the body and the blood of Christ. Guilty of it. If you do it unworthily. So what do? We sit down and we think about, Lord, am I worthy? Lord, have I done this right? Lord, am I living for you right? Have I entered into this with you properly? Do you know that I know apostolic Christians who've been in church for 20 years, 25 years, who have never taken communion? Do you know why? Because they're afraid. They read this passage and they get, mortified. Oh no, I'm afraid. Am I right? Well, what I'm trying to explain to you today is to explain to you why, if you're trying to live for the Lord, you don't have to be afraid of communion.
All right.
But understand this, that in this passage it says, many among you are sick and weak and asleep. And this passage uses the word asleep. It doesn't mean that they took a nap. It means they're dead. Because the Lord chastens his own. He disciplines his own. If Pastor Anthony's daughters are running around the church and being loud, do I have a right to go grab them by the arm and go say, hey, what are you doing? Or maybe even spank them? No, absolutely not. They're not my kids. But when Israel was little, and when Israel was running around the church, and when Israel was being loud, me and Israel would have an appointment in the men's room. And all of a sudden, Israel was a better man for it. Or a better child. And he was better in church. Because God loves us and he's going to chasten us. He's going to discipline us. Because he wants us to be better people. Excuse me, church, I gotta do something about this iPad because it keeps shutting off and going back to the beginning. Now it says to discern the Lord's body.
Right.
What does the word discern mean? The word discern means to recognize, to honor, to identify. To recognize, to honor, and to identify. He said, many among you are sick, weak, and asleep. Why? Because they're not properly discerning the body. when they're not properly recognizing, honoring, or identifying the body. Now, church, we can get all spooky spiritual like the Catholics do. Sorry, I don't mean to offend any Catholics today. But the teaching in the Catholic Church is that when you see the wafer and when you see the wine, that it's wine and it's a wafer until it gets in the cup and until it gets in your hand, and then somehow or another, some supernatural way, it literally becomes the blood of Jesus and it literally becomes the body of Jesus. And when you eat it, you're literally taking in the blood and you're literally taking in the body of Christ. But when the Lord speaks, he said that these words are spiritual. That they're not literal. The blood, the cup doesn't become the literal blood of Christ.
Right.
The bread does not become the literal body of Christ. Because the body that he's talking about isn't the body that walked this earth some 2,000 years ago. The body that he's talking about isn't the body that was literally nailed to a cross some 2,000 years ago. There is a literal body. There's also a spiritual body. Not properly discerning the body. 1 Corinthians 10, 15, and 17. I speak as the wise men, judge ye what I say. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body.
All right.
For we are all partakers of that one bread. Yep. Did you catch that, church? For we being many are what? One bread. What is he talking about? Communion. We being many are one bread. What are we supposed to properly discern, recognize, honor, and identify? The body. We are the body. So when we take communion, we're partaking of the body. Romans 12, 4 and 5. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one another. Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. And hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Colossians 1:24, who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church.
All right.
Now, when we take communion, Sister Brianna, did you put that picture up there? When we take communion and we look at the, do we have a picture with the bread too? Okay, so when we take communion, this is what we see. We see the little cups, we see the little bread. But understand that all this is a symbol. All this is something to put us in the right mind of what we're about to do. Communion is our entering into covenant relationship, a contractual agreement based on love with Jesus. When we're saying, yes, Lord, I want my sins to be taken away. Yes, Lord, I want them to be washed away. Yes, Lord, I want to be justified by your blood. I want these things in my life. I want it to be taken into my very being.
Yes.
The bread, I'm properly discerning the body. Wait a minute. I need you.
Right. That's right.
You're part of the body.
That's right.
I need you, brother.
That's right.
You're part of my life.
That's right.
I need you.
Talk to us, Jesus.
I need you.
Community.
You're part of the body. You're part of my body.
That's right.
Because I'm part of the body of Christ.
Right.
I want to be part of the body of Christ.
Yeah.
Are we not, we being many or what? One bread.
Yeah.
I want to be in fellowship, in covenant relationship, with one body. You may have a different office, you may have a different function, but you're part of the body.
Right.
So when I take communion, what I'm saying is I'm saying, yes, Lord, I want to remember your ministry through my life. I want to live out the things that you've done. I want to take your ministry, your life, your teaching, your spirit into my being. I want to receive the forgiveness, the washing away of my sins. I want to be justified before you. And I agree to be part of the body of Christ, to be a functioning member of the very body of Christ in the earth, to be a useful member. And I will not look at my brother or my sister and say, I have no need of you. When we take communion, church, we're not just doing something that's a ritual.
Right.
Yes. We're not just doing something that's just, oh, this is just one of the things that happen in the church. I'm going to tell you right now my personal feelings on something. Some churches overdo it. Churches every Sunday. I mean communion, not church. Communion's every Sunday. So every Sunday they take communion and it becomes just part of church. It's like the offering. It's no big deal. And then there's those of us who don't do communion enough. So nobody understands the depth of what's been taking place, what was taking place. We need to understand that this is just as much a part of our walk with the Lord as anything else that we know as part of our walk with the Lord. In fact, when Jesus says, I will raise him up at the last day, he's talking about that if you haven't agreed to receive my forgiveness, if you haven't agreed to be forgiven, to be cleansed, to be justified, if you don't consider yourself and every other member of the body of Christ as one, and you part of that one, you're not worthy to be raised up at the last day. But if you've done it, now you won't. Now you won't. So we accept the conditions of one body and unity in Christ. John 13:34-35 says this, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one another.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Church, the scripture says this. Now, this is something that we do when we take communion. I do it every time I give a communion. The scripture said, examine yourself. The scripture says that if we judge ourselves, we'll not be judged. Mm-hmm. So if we take the standard of Jesus Christ, and we look at his life, and we look at what he did, and the way he spoke to people, the way he interacted with people, the way he loved, the way he shared, the way he gave. And we compare it to ourselves. Now we're judging ourselves. And we're saying, do I live up to this thing? You're going to say no. But this is what you're supposed to say. And I want to. And I want to. I want to live up to that standard. I want to take his presence, his ministry, his words, his spirit into my very being. I want to take him. I want to be one with the body. I feel, church, like the Lord has been ministering to us on new days. The Lord has been saying to us that we need to become truly one body, with one vision, one goal, one purpose. You hear Pastor getting up and talk about the ministry, having his breakfast, and how we're all going to share our visions. God has spoken that thing for a purpose, to get us in one mind,
right,
and one accord, to create unity. But I'm going to tell you something right now. The unity of the church isn't only for the supposed leadership.
That's right.
Okay? And please understand, when I say supposed leadership, okay, I have a head, and I have a body. But if I disconnect my head from my body, I'm good for nothing. Okay? So, the body needs the head just as much as the head needs the body.
Right.
So this is what I'm going to do in closing. I'm going to ask you, church, that after what you just heard, that I hope that I've shed some light on communion and what it really means and what you're actually doing when you partake of it. I hope you come to an understanding that it's a very serious thing. Because if you say you want to be part of the body of Christ, but you don't accept your obligation, remember, yes, I want to be part of the body. Yes, I want to walk in unity. Yes, I need my brothers and sisters. I'm not going to walk in bitterness. I'm not going to walk in unforgiveness. But I'm going to love one another as Christ loved the church. By this, they will know that I'm his disciples, by the love we have one for another. But if you want to enter into this and you're not prepared to do that, then you're becoming one of his. And guess what? He has the right to chastise you. He has the right to correct you as your kids. Just like I have the right to correct my kids. So examine yourself now. Judge yourself now. And say, Lord, do I truly want your blood in my life? Lord, do I truly want to be part of the body of Christ? I accept, Lord God. I'm not going to use the word accept. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your cleansing. I receive your justification. I receive my part and my place in the body. And I understand that in order to do this, that I have to remember you. Solve yourself. Come to the altar and judge yourself.
True.